Scholastic Audio presents Spirit Animals, Fall of the Beasts, Book 1, Immortal Guardians, by Eliot Schrefer, read by Nicola Barber. Chapter 1. Market Day. If only she could turn right around and go home. Normally, Kaina lived with her tribe, day in and day out. She hadn't been around this many unknown people for years, not since she had once come with her mother to this very marketplace as a little girl. But she was 12 now, which meant she'd have to start taking her turn trekking to the jungle market to buy supplies for her tribe. Everyone had requests. Oranges for her father, a new hunting blade for her mother, sugar fruit for her brother. Thinking of how happy her family would be with their presence gave Kaina the courage she needed. Holding her head high, she stepped into the clearing. She picked her way between the woven mats, perusing the goods carefully laid out on each. Fragrant herbs, wild pineapple and celery, grouse eggs. Her stomach growled as she passed among the vendors. To prevent herself from wasting her tribe's money, she recited her short list in her mind like a mantra. Oranges, a hunting blade, sugar fruit. Vendors beckoned to Kaina as she passed, but she timidly avoided their eyes. She'd never bartered before and was worried they'd take advantage of her the moment she showed interest in what they were selling.
Kaina!
She looked up, startled, and was relieved to see a familiar old woman scamper agilely through the crowded vendor mats and come to Kaina's side, warmly taking the girl's hands in her own. Kaina relaxed. Prana was an elderly woman who travelled between the tribes, bartering her pottery. Kaina had known her for years and had never seen Prana without a smile on her old, cracked face. Prana's spirit animal, a brilliant brass kingfisher, was perched on the woman's long grey braid, its delicate feet hooked into the folds of silvered hair. The bird hopped to Kaina's shoulder, warbling a cheerful, tuneless song.
I wish I had a spirit animal, Kaina thought. Then I'd always have company and wouldn't have to come to market day alone.
But some people bonded with spirit animals and some didn't. There was no predicting it, and Kaina hadn't summoned one.
He is not usually this excited to see anyone. He really likes you, Prana said.
Kaina took a moment to run her hand over the bird's smooth and glossy plumage. He raised his chin, inviting her to preen his underfeathers. Kaina smiled and obliged. Just then, Prana's kingfisher took to the air and began to shriek. From all around, the trees shook. Monkeys screamed. Cicadas droned. Songbirds chattered. Kaina felt a strange, dizzy sensation wash over her, and the market fell into silence. The ground seemed to tilt beneath Kaina's bare feet.
What is happening? She cried out.
Though only moments before she'd been so hot she was sweating, Kaina shivered with a sudden chill. The sky went dark, and the clouds turned rageful and knitted together. She heard a boom and a crack, and her eyes filled with light. The explosion knocked Kaina and Prana to the ground. Ears ringing, Kaina's first thought was to help the elderly woman up. But Prana was already back on her feet, tears in her rheumy eyes. Blinking her own eyes rapidly to clear the purple flash, Kaina raised herself onto her elbows. As quickly as they'd formed, the clouds scattered. The clearing was once again full of radiant sunshine, its brilliance frosting the silhouette of a giant creature where just moments before there had been nothing.
It is not possible, Prana whispered.
But it was. An elephant had appeared. The massive beast bowed its head, trunk slung low and snuffling along the ground. Kaina had seen plenty of forest elephants in the jungle, but none as big as this one. Its broad ears swayed as it made its way toward Kaina and Prana. Vendors and tribespeople alike fled to the edges of the market, watching with fearful curiosity. Kaina's legs were rooted to the ground.
Do you know this elephant? She stammered to Prana. Where did it come from? And why is it coming toward you?
toward me, child, Prana said, wonder in her voice. It's coming toward you.
I don't understand, Kaina cried, tears blurring her vision.
You've summoned a spirit animal, Prana said.
She had placed a wizened hand over her mouth, making her words almost inaudible.
But an elephant, the eyes, it's impossible. Kaina, you've summoned Dinesh.
Dinesh? A creature of legend, one of the great beasts of Erdas? It felt as if the earth went soft beneath Kaina, as if she'd stepped into slip mud. The elephant slowed as it came near, and Kaina was shocked to see it lower its great head. Brilliant aqua eyes met hers, and they flashed with intelligence and something almost like amusement as they took in the cowering market goers. Could this animal truly be the great Dinesh?
Say hello, Prana encouraged. He's waiting to meet you.
The creature's expression softened, and Kaina found her legs were able to move again. Despite the dozens of eyes she could feel on her back, despite the ruckus of the upturned earth and the bizarre sight of an enormous elephant standing on the woven mats, Kaina didn't shrink away. She wanted to touch him. A charge was building up inside her, setting her skin tingling, and she knew instinctively that only one thing would settle it. Hands trembling, she strode to the elephant and leaned in close, so their faces were mere inches apart. As she ran the back of her hand along his leathery ear and closed her eyes, a serene warmth filled her. Kaina felt a moist touch on her neck. Opening her eyes, she smiled as she saw that Dinesh's large trunk was nuzzling her, comforting her. Suddenly, she felt as large as the elephant somehow, too large to be intimidated by a crowded marketplace. It seemed ridiculous that she'd ever been. Kaina hesitantly laid a hand against the elephant's flank. His flesh was rough and thick, his giant torso rising and falling beneath her fingers. She looked into the elephant's eyes and saw a vast intelligence gazing back. How could I have summoned Dinesh? Kaina asked in wonder. And why to me?
Before Prana could answer, a man in a black tunic stepped forward.
This is indeed an auspicious morning, the stranger called. The great beasts are returning, and I have been sent to shepherd them to safety.
Prana's golden kingfisher pointed his sharp beak shrewdly at the man. Kaina's attention was drawn to the charcoal-coloured spiral on the man's forehead. She could see now that it was raised and swollen, more of a brand than a tattoo. It almost appeared to ripple in the wavering heat. But after the shock of the last few moments, Kaina wasn't sure she could trust her senses. She leaned into Dinesh's side for security and took comfort in the slow rise and fall of his ribs.
You may leave the girl and her elephant in my care, old one. I will handle it from here.
The elephant raised his trunk into the air, letting out a deep trumpeting call, the sound powerful enough to reverberate deep in Kaina's chest. From elsewhere in the jungle, other elephants called in response. When she heard distant crashing sounds, Kaina realized the other elephants were converging on them. Dinesh tossed his head in the stranger's direction, lowering his tusks and leveling them toward the man in the black tunic. Kaina stroked Dinesh's ear and saw that the elephant's eyes were full of distrust.
Kalistana, Kaina whispered to Prana in the local language. Beware.
Before Prana could respond, the stranger stepped toward them. He was handsome and tan-skinned, a trim beard covering his jaw.
Siaga, he said, a wicked grin splitting his face. I speak your language, and yes, you should be afraid.
The treetops again began to shake, and the nearby monkeys and birds recommenced their shrieking. The cicadas went from a low drone to a roar. Kaina looked to Dinesh, hoping to discover in the elephant's soft eyes that she had nothing to fear. But fear was precisely what Kaina found there. Dinesh took a step forward and then a step back, lowering his head nervously. Kaina followed his gaze and saw a thicket of spiny jungle growth tremble and shake. As the branches bent farther and whatever creature was behind them began to emerge, Dinesh trumpeted again. "What's wrong?" Kaina cried out. The powerful vibration of the elephant's call rattled in her head. Market-goers had begun to approach from their safe vantage, but paused after they heard the elephant's trumpet. It was a good thing they did, too, as Dinesh suddenly charged. They scurried to get out of the way, but the elephant was only halfway across the clearing when he abruptly halted, momentum hurtling his body through the dirt and nearly pitching him forward. Emerging from the thicket was another huge creature. It was a bear, but unlike any Kaina had ever seen. She'd been taught that bears were always brown or black, but this one was white, its fur as light as morning clouds against the vibrant blacks and greens of the jungle. Baffled, Kaina wheeled and caught Prana's startled eyes.
"What wrongness has come to our world?" Prana cried, her hand to her heart.
There was a cry from the sky, and a large eagle descended, lowering so it was flapping above the polar bear. Then there was a roar from the other side of the clearing, and Kaina pivoted to see a giant boar, thick-tusked and bristly. Blinded by fear, Kaina ran toward Prana, but was blocked by a new creature, this one a muscular beast on all fours, like a stocky antelope, but with curling horns on its head. It used those horns to butt into Prana, who staggered and fell before Kaina's eyes. Her kingfisher hovered, trying ineffectually to stop the beast's assault. Kaina backed up, hands outstretched as she sought the company of her newfound spirit animal. Dinesh wasn't hard to find, trumpeting and screaming as he whirled in the center of the clearing, facing off against both the polar bear and the boar. Standing calmly between the two attacking beasts was the stranger in the black tunic. "Why are you doing this?" Kaina cried. The man didn't answer. Hearing Kaina's distress, Dinesh pivoted to face her. With one clean motion, he whipped his trunk around, caught the girl around the waist, and deposited her securely on his broad back. He immediately returned to fending off the bear and the boar, whipping his great tusks through the air to keep them at bay. The stranger grinned at Kaina. The spiral on his forehead was definitely moving now, writhing under his flesh.
"Haven't you figured it out? I am collecting the great beasts, and Dinesh is my next trophy."
With that, the man pulled an obsidian vial out of a pouch at his waist and unstopped it. A feeling of cold dread passed through her. The polar bear and the boar had spread out. The elephant turned in nervous circles. With the other great beasts flanking him, Dinesh could no longer fend off both attackers at once. Kaina wondered how much longer his tusks would keep them safe. With a rush of wind, the eagle was there. It hovered beside the bearded man, who placed the mysterious black vial in its talons. With a few flaps of its strong wings, the eagle flew up toward Kaina. She cringed, clenching her legs tightly against Dinesh as she instinctively threw her arms before her face. But the eagle wasn't coming for her. Kaina watched in horror as it dexterously turned the vial in its talons, letting the contents fall onto Dinesh's broad forehead. At first, Kaina thought it was a piece of grey mud inside. But then she saw the glob start moving and realized it was a worm, or a leech, the same size and shape as the twisting spiral on the stranger's forehead. Kaina leaned forward desperately, hoping to use the back of her hand to wipe the little monster off Dinesh. But the worm was surprisingly fast. It wriggled over Dinesh's forehead, easily sticking to the elephant's hide, no matter how frantically he tried to shake it. The worm pressed its toothy sucker mouth against Dinesh time and again, but was clearly finding it hard to get through Dinesh's tough skin. Kaina swatted at it, but the wriggling creature was too fast. It lurched for Dinesh's ear, soon disappearing in the folds. She realized how far it had gotten when she heard the elephant cry out in pain and shake his head furiously. Dinesh began to tremble and shudder beneath Kaina's thighs. He lifted his head and trumpeted one more time, a terrible, anguished cry. Then he went quiet and still. The bear and the boar relented, stepping back from the elephant.
"Dinesh!" Kaina yelled. Her hands were clamped on the elephant's head. "Are you okay? Dinesh!"
He was motionless.
"At least you had a few moments with your spirit animal," the man said. "Some I don't even give that much."
Kaina rubbed the elephant's hide, hoping Dinesh would reawaken to her touch. But the electricity was gone, and the elephant remained still. The boar relaxed and sat in the dirt, while the bear panted heavily in the jungle heat, tongue lolling out of its mouth. Kaina felt suddenly lightheaded, like she might pass out from shock. The stranger in black tugged at the length of rawhide that tied the collar of his shirt closed, exposing a broad chest. In the middle of it, right in the triangle where his abdomen began, was a tattoo of what looked like a cobra. The stranger closed his eyes, his brow wrinkling with concentration. Then, with a flash, the bear and boar had disappeared, appearing on the man's chest, one on either side, forelimbs reaching out onto the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.